Hi everyone and welcome back. In this video we are going to talk about how to execute asynchronous code in a loop. Now that loop can be a simple for loop, for in loop, for of loop, for each loop, map, filter, reduce. Okay, how actually we can write asynchronous code either in using promises, using callback, using async await in a loop. Okay, so to understand this, first we will try to understand the basic JavaScript examples. Okay, like I will put this example and we will try to see what this example is doing. Okay, so in this example what we are doing is we are running a for loop and we are executing set timeout function. So what is the expected output according to you for this example? This is the for loop, we have a set timeout, and surprisingly the output comes as 555, right? 5 times. So set timeout function in JavaScript usually takes a callback. So this is what callback it is taking, right? As an argument, a callback function is a function that is executed after another function finishes running, right? So here we are running while I equal to 0 to I is less than array dot length I plus plus. So set timeout will take a time like 1 second to execute this array of I, but when we are executing this array of I, the value of I is already 5. Okay, and with the concept of closure in JavaScript code, on this particular line we are able to access the outermost value of this I, which is currently 5, right? So when console.log it executed, you will see the 5 times. Okay, so why that is happening? That is happening because this is asynchronous code and we are not maintaining the scope of this value I for each iteration. I is already 5 and then set timeout is getting executed after 1 second, and at this point of time we are using arrow functions and all, we are able to access, I mean this is the closure, and we are able to access the value from the outside scope, right? So value of I is already 5 in this particular case, so we will print that value. So what all solutions we see for this kind of a problem? One simple solution is, okay, let's convert var to let. When you convert var to let actually provides the block level scoping, so it will maintain the scope of value I for each and every iteration. Another thing is you can actually create a separate function and put a delay. So consider something like this. Here I have an array, I put a delay. Okay, so now we don't have that problem of closure and it will print the value comfortably without any problem. Okay, this is just to avoid the closure. This is just to avoid the block level scoping, I mean the global scoping. Here now we have block level scoping and value of I will be available for each iteration. Another fix is we can actually use the if block immediately invoking functional expression. Okay, what this is about, like we are writing a for loop here. If I just try to fix it here, so we can actually create a if block. If block is nothing but expression something like this, a function which is calling itself. Okay, yeah, so this function will call itself, right? This is the if block. You can see this highlighted block is immediately invoking functional expression because this function is invoking itself and maintaining its own scope. Okay, so when I equal to 0, it will see, okay, alert hello. Here you can actually print the array value I and all, like we have the array. I am not using array here. I equal to 0, I is less than array dot length I plus plus, and what we are doing is we are trying to print console.log array is still accessible here and we are just passing the index. So this is an immediately invoke function, and this is where we are calling this function by passing the value of I, and there is a set timeout which we keeps increasing. This I is passed, so the I value of I will be maintained for each and every functional expression. I will be 1 will be passed, I will be 2 will be passed here. Okay, this is how we can fix. This is a very basic examples, but in the real time examples how we can actually call the asynchronous code. Set timeout is very basic examples and we can fix it by just creating a separate function using the let keyword or just creating a if block for our code. But in real time example, if we just try to take a look on to simple example I'm going to write. So here I have a fruit basket. It has some set of fruits, okay. I will just copy some code snippets which we are going to talk here, and then we will talk on that. So this is a fruit basket, and I have just a simple function const get fruit count. Okay, that function is doing nothing but it's an arrow function, you can say. It is taking fruit count and returning the value. What it is returning is fruit basket. And whatever the count you are passing, whatever the fruit you are passing. Okay, simple function which will just return some kind of a count. Now, how I can actually execute this function with some promise or with some delay? So what I created is I created some sleep function, and this is the millisecond I have, and I will just delay the execution of this function with some this much of time return. Here I'm just returning new promise. Sorry. Set timeout, and I will resolve this function after this much time. Okay, simple delay function I have added. Now, how can I actually use this sleep function in my code? Here I can write one more function, const get fruit count. Okay, here I'm passing the fruit. Okay, so what I can do is I can just use simply this read sleep function, return sleep. Okay, this sleep function is taking some milliseconds as an argument, okay, 1000 milliseconds, and it is returning a promise, right? Once it is returning a promise, maybe some argument, then we will call fruit basket function. You can actually call this function get fruit count, and you can pass the fruit. Okay, simple way to delay the functional execution, right? Now, same thing. Now, this get fruit count is nothing but it's asynchronous code. It is using the sleep function. Sleep function is returning a promise, and then we are doing dot then. So there is a delay of 1 second we have acquired in this function. Now, this kind of sequence, right? Now, what you can do is you can actually get fruit count is returning a value, right? So it is also returning a promise. So you can actually do a get fruit count dot then function. Simply, it's the same name. Or we can actually change it a little bit. Here we are just getting this array values. Okay, fruit basket, so it will just give you the count, and this is the promise. Once this promise is resolved, then dot then will execute, and it is just returning a simple value. Right, it is returning a simple value, but it is, I mean, if you are returning anything from the resolve function, this is a resolve function, that means it is returning a resolved promise. So here we are saying fetch fruit, let's say, you can write a promise on that. Fetch fruit, and you will just pass apple. This is also returning a promise. Dot then we got the count. I just extend this example with some intermediate function just to show it. Okay, this is just a simple example of promises and adding a delay, right? Sleep function I have added, and then fruit basket and passing the count. This is also returning some value. So this is intermediately returning a promise to us, resolved promise. So we are doing dot then and we are getting it. Okay. Now, what if in the same example we wanted to execute in a promise, in a loop, say, like there is a for each loop map and all. And what you wanted to do is you wanted to execute this function in a particular loop. So we will extend this example and we will start writing our code. Here our the main application will start. This fetch fruit can be anything. This function can be anything. You can make a API call, and that is also asynchronous code, or you can talk about set timeout function, or you may talk about the callback. We just need some utility function which is returning a promise. We can simply say, okay, this function we can use sleep, which is returning a promise. Okay. And we have simple loop. Okay. Like I have written one function, get fruit count. And what it is doing is, it can be a async function. I mean, there are many ways of writing async function. Here you can write it, or you can just create a constant, const get fruit count, and here you can call async and put an arrow function, and here you can write your code. Okay, so what we are doing in this is we are running a loop. Okay, so if we just do let index equal to 0, index dot so is less than, okay, say 5, and I plus plus, sorry, index plus plus. And how can we execute asynchronous code inside this for loop? Is async await, we are already using async, so we can await for the fruit. We can await. This is a simple example. Count or whatever the synchronous function, I'm not putting any name. It can be any function, maybe an HTTP call, maybe a file read or something. Okay, and you are just passing the fruit. Okay, this is the one way. So you keep actually getting the fruit and we are just printing it, and this is how it will work. Right, simple for each or simple for loop. We are awaiting and we have actually returned this function as async. Okay, so this will work perfectly fine. We are able to execute this with this. Now get fruit count can be a function which is returning a promise. Here I can just write it something XYZ. Here what it is doing is return new promise. Here it is resolving and rejecting. In our case, what we are doing is we are just resolving it with some data. String data, that's it. So this get fruit count, let's change the function names. Here get fruit count we are calling, this is returning a promise. So this await will wait for each and every iteration, then it will go to the next iteration, then it will go to the next iteration. This is how it will work, because await will actually block the execution. It will not take you to the next index until this is resolved. Okay, so there are better ways. You actually create a promise array and then resolve all these together, because it will, you can say there is a set timeout already written inside it, so after a particular duration only. Okay, so let's extend this example a little bit. Here I have written a set timeout, and in set timeout I am actually printing this, or you can say resolving this, after a particular duration only, and duration is 1 second. So you will be able to see the data coming, or whatever the value we are returning, coming after every second. Okay, 1 second it will execute this, promise is returned, then it will go to the next iteration. Right, similarly, we can use the for each methods and all. Like in the same function, if I just replace the for loop with for each. So this is considered that this is an array, okay. This is an array of string. Yes, this is an array of string. Like apple we have. Right, and we are doing a for each on array. Here we are actually creating the, in the callback function, we are converting that to async await. I mean, in this particular case, there is no point of making your parent function async. Okay, what we can do is, here we are actually running a loop onto this array. Okay, so you might be thinking about why can't we make it async? Because this is an inner function, and whenever you are writing await, then outermost function should have async block already associated there. Okay, And in this, async is there, await is there, so you will wait for the each fruit count to come. This is returning a promise. Okay, so this is how you can do with the for each block. Okay, so for each function is pretty much straightforward because the use of for each is to iterate. So if you wanted to run a promise, like if you wanted to use async await with for each, then what we simply do is, this is an array, okay, array of fruits like apple. And what we are doing, we are just running a for each loop, and in this callback function we can write async await. Okay, so here number of fruit, it will actually wait for getting the result from this particular function, which is returning a promise. It can be a simple, you can say this particular function here, you can just move it to the top. Consider that this function is calling this. Okay, and this is not taking any input. Okay, we are calling this, and this is returning a promise, so we are waiting for it, and then we are printing it. So for each is just for iteration, but in the case of map, it will be a little different use case. Consider that this is our function which we wanted to execute. So we'll just write a simple getFruitCount method. Okay, this is a simple getFruitCount method, and now what we will do is we will write a simple map function to iterate onto some array, and we'll call this function. Okay, so first of all, why map is different from for each? Okay, so map is designed to return a new array. Same as filter. Filter will do the filtration on the data, and it will return the filtered output without doing any manipulation. But map, in this you can actually change the behavior of the object, but like you are iterating onto the object array, then you can change the properties, you can return the desired object, but it will not change the existing array object, it will return the new array object. So this is how map is different from filter and for each. Okay, so what we are trying to achieve with map is the same thing, same kind of a loop we will execute. So consider if you write a function const map loop, okay, and here this is async function again because we are going to write await in this, so we'll make it async. Okay, and what we are doing is const fruits equal to, here we will do await, and this is an array we have, a hard-coded array for now, apple, and here we are doing map. In this map, what we do is we actually get an array, we iterate onto the elements and we return them. Here you will be making a call to maybe a get fruit count, and we'll be passing the value. So here we already have async, and we are waiting for this particular array to get resolved. We have to use async here, right? Because we are writing await. So this async will point to this await, and this async will point to this await. But still, if we just try to print this out, the values, because we have to return the out. This out is nothing but a promise here. So if you just try to see what we are getting from this fruits array, because we are returning this fruits array from this function, then it will contain all the promises inside it. Because the behavior, the map function is designed, if you use await in a map, map will always return an array of promises. This is because asynchronous function will always return a promises. Okay, since map will always return a promise, if you use await, you have to wait the array promise to get resolved, right? That's why we put await here. So how can we actually fix this? When you run this code, you will actually get the array of promises, nothing else. You will not be getting the data. This fruits is nothing but an array of promises. So what we can do is, can we just try to use the promise.all function here, and we'll see. Okay, so what we will do is we'll just modify this function here and do a promise.all. So what promise.all will be doing, we got all the fruits, so instead of returning it, what we will return, await promise.all, and we'll pass all the promises array. This is simple, right? Or you can actually get it on some data, await promise.all. So here we are actually passing all the promises and then you return it. This is just for an example. Okay, so this is how we can await for all the promises to get resolved. Here from this we are getting the array of promises, but we can use promise.all to run all the promises together. So whatever the code we have written, this is the most optimized, because now these promises will execute parallelly using promise.all utility. Okay, if you see this code, we can actually call this as a promises. Okay, we are getting all the promises and we are passing that in the promise.all. Okay, we are using await, async await utility here. The function is async and we are writing await. We are waiting for this promise to be returned, either resolved or rejected. And this map is returning a promise array, which we are resolving all the promises together using promise.all. Similarly, we have other methods also, like map is actually also used to do the manipulation in the data. If you want to actually just add some values, currently this out is a promise, right? So what you will do is you can actually update this value which you are returning, but it will still be a promise, but the value you can modify here. You can change the value to, okay, I want to increase it to 10. Okay, so we can actually update the data which is being returned. We can modify that. We can modify that and we can return it. Okay, so this is how we can do it. Now another thing is, what if we wanted to use await with filter, a simple use case. So in that case, simple filter, how we write to get, this is a synchronous code, which what it is doing is it is running a filter on the array. Okay, this is, you can say Apple, it is running filter and it is returning the data based on the condition check. So it will return only those indexes which are satisfying this condition, and it will return the new array, not the existing array. Okay, so here also what we will do is we'll run a loop onto it. Async await block you can execute simply like here, await. Here instead of map we will change it to filter. Okay, and number of fruits. So when we are using, so await in filter doesn't work the same way. In fact, it doesn't work at all. You will get the unfiltered array back. Okay, so if you just try to do this in this particular way, get fruits await and number of fruits, here we will be just checking condition out is greater than 20. This particular condition you have written, right? We are just trying this particular syntax first to just deal with the filter. We talked about map, now we are using the filter, right? So how filter works, when you use await in a filter callback, the callback always returns a promise. Since the promise is always truthy, so you see this is returning a promise and promise is always truthy, so you will get a random array. So what you have to do is use map to return an array of promise, await the array of promise, and then use filter on top of it. Okay, so the same function, if we wanted to apply a filter on this, first we have to do the map. So we can actually go back to the previous syntax. Here we are doing first map. Okay, here from this map to the loop, it will give us the values. Okay, and once we get the values, you can synchronously filter out the values from it. Okay, promise.all, you can say I got const data. Okay, and here you can do actually return data.filter, and here you can put the condition if I is greater than 30 or whatever it is. So we are getting now the proper values. So what we are doing is, first we are actually getting all the set of promises using map, then we are resolving all the promises, getting the actual data, and then we are applying the filter on the actual array instead of promises. So earlier if you just change this map to filter, that will also not work, because it will again be a set of array promises and those are always truthy when you do the filter. Okay, so you will get a random results. Similarly, you can actually use async with reduce function, which actually sends the output of the previous iteration to the next iteration. So I mean, with await, this again get extremely messy when you use await instead of reduce. So if you just talk a simple example about how reduce works, First, we'll talk about reduce. So this is a simple reduce function which is acting on an array. Okay, sum is the accumulator function and fruits, right? We are just keep summing the fruit count values initialized with zero. Okay, now if you just try to use this reduce function with async await, then what you will do is, this is await array and here you will do reduce. And it will have a two things, async, the accumulator function sum and fruit, and from the return you will actually first you have to get the fruit count or whatever it is, and then you have to return the sum of two things, sum plus fruit count. This is how we generally write the reduce function, right? So here also again you will get the, this is again going to return a promise, this particular loop, right? So how we can do this? So initially the sum is zero in this accumulator function which we have written. Sum is zero, then it will actually resolve this get fruit count, which will return you some value, and it will sum it, and then it will return a promise out of it. So same thing, what we have to do is we have to actually await for this particular sum function. This is a little tricky. Promise sum. So this accumulator function we have to write, promise sum. So this promise sum will take care of that. First we have to resolve the data which is coming from the previous iteration, and then you can pass it, promise sum, sum can be passed to the now summation. Okay, this means you can use await in reduce callback, but you have to remember to await the accumulator first. This is still a little bit tricky than map and filter. Filter you can't use independently. First you have to map, you have to resolve all the promises, you have to get the actual array, then you have to filter it. For a simple map, you will return a promises, so you have to use promise.all to get the actual values. For filter, first you have to resolve all the promises using promise.all using map, you got the actual array, then you do the filter. Coming to the reduce, this is simple reduce function, this is how it works, but when you actually implement it, this is accumulator and this is the values, right, and we are summing it. But in this particular case, before sending the output of previous iteration to the next iteration, that accumulator function should use await to get the actual value. This is the only fix you have to do if we are using await, async await with reduce. Okay, so I think we have talked much. If you are not able to understand it and all, then I will also have a blog on it. I hope I made all these things clear, like how to run the asynchronous code in a loop using async await. Okay, and we already know how to use this promise.all. Once you have a multiple promises in an array, you can use promise.all to resolve all these things together. Okay, we used async await in the for each, in the map, in the filter, and in the reduce. Okay, that's it. Thanks everyone. Okay, little trick I wanted to explain, a simple trick to combine all these map, filter, reduce together. This is a code snippet. Okay, so what you can do is, once when you are doing a promises, right, this is a function which is going to return a promise to me. So consider this const. It's actually some function which is returning okay. I will just write some dummy things, resolve and reject, correct? So it is returning a promise. So what you can do is, for all the promises, first you have to resolve all these using promise.all. Once you get the data, now you can actually run the filter on this. Okay, here now you got filtered out equal to, you can just do number of fruits dot filter. So here you can combine the filter and reduce together in the short function. Here I have filter, I'm doing it if I is greater than 50. So I can use now filter and reduce both the functions, and it will actually return the new array, so we don't need to worry about changing the existing array, right? But first what you need to do, you have to resolve the promises which you are getting from the map function, right? The same code we have written in a little different way. Okay, so that's it, guys. Thanks, everyone.